The Ancestors of Peter Atherly. By Bret Harte. Podcast 2 of 3. Chapter 3. A hot afternoon on the plains. A dusty cavalcade of United States cavalry and commissary wagons, which from a distance preserved a certain military precision of movement, but on nearer view resolved itself into straggling troopers in twos and fours interspersed between the wagons, two non-commissioned officers and a guide riding ahead, who had already fallen into the cavalry slouch, but off to the right, smartly erect and cadet-like, the young lieutenant in command. A wide road that had the appearance of being at once well-traveled and yet deserted, and that, although well-defined underfoot, still seemed to disappear and lose itself 100 feet ahead in the monotonous level. A horizon that in that clear, dry, hazeless atmosphere never mocked you, yet never changed, but kept its eternal rim of mountains at the same height and distance from hour to hour and day to day. Dust, a parching alkaline powder that cracked the skin everywhere, clinging to the hubs and spokes of the wheels, without being disturbed by movement, encrusting the cavalryman from his high boots to the crossed sabers of his cap, going off in small puffs like explosions under the plunging hoofs of the horses, but too heavy to rise and follow them. A reeking smell of horse sweat and boot leather that lingered in the road long after the train had passed. An external silence broken only by the cough of a jaded horse in the suffocating dust, or the cracking of harness leather. Within one of the wagons that seemed a miracle of military neatness and methodical stowage, a lazy conversation carried on by a grizzled driver and sun-browned farrier. "Who be you?" says he. "I'm Philip Atherly, a member of Congress," says the long, dark-complected man, says he, "and I'm on a commission for looking into this year engine grievance," says he. "You may be God Almighty," says Nebraska Bill, says he, "but you look a DD sight more like a hostilin' Apache, and we don't want any of your psalm singing, big talkin' peacemakers interferin' with our ways of treatin' pizen, you hear me? I'm shoutin'," says he. With that the dark-complected man's eyes began to glisten, and he sorter squirmed all over to get at Bill, and Bill outs with his battery woe, "Well, yeah, what's up with you now?" The latter remark was directed to the young spirited near horse he was driving, who was beginning to be strangely excited. "What happened then?" said the farrier lazily. "Well," continued the driver, having momentarily quieted his horse, "I reckoned it was about time for me to wheel into line. Four fellers of the Bill stripe, out on the plains, would easily plug a man in citizen's clothes, even if he was the president himself, as they would drop on an engine or a racial expletive. Look here, Bill," says I'm escorting this stranger under government orders, and I'm responsible for him. I ain't allowed to waste government powder and shot on your kind unless I've orders, but if you'll wait till I strip off this shell I'll lam the stuff in outer ye, afore the stranger." With that Bill just danced with rage, but dasn't fire, for he knew, and I knew, that if he'd plugged me he'd been a dead frontiersman afore the next morning. But you'd have had to give him up to the authorities, and a jury of his own kind would have set him free. Not much. If you hadn't just joined, you'd know that ain't the way O 30th Cavalry," returned the driver. "The colonel would have issued his orders to bring in Bill dead or alive, and the 30th would have managed to bring him in dead. Then your jury might have sat on him. Tell you what, chaps of the Bill stripe don't care over much to tackle the yaller braid. But what's this your congressman interferin' for, anyway? He's a rich Californian. Thinks he's got a call, I reckon, to look arter Injuns, just as them abolitionists looked arter slaves. And get hated just as they was by the folks here and as we are, too, for the matter of that." "Well, I dunno," rejoined the farrier, "it don't seem natural for white men to quarrel with each other about the way to treat an Injun, and that Injun lying in ambush to shoot em both. And if government would only make up its mind how to treat em, instead of one day pretending to be their great father and treating them like babies, and the next making treaties with em like as they was foreigners, and the next sending out a handful of us to lick 10,000 of them, what's the use of one regiment even to age in a nation on their own ground? A nation and on their own ground, that's just war, you've hit it, softy. That's the argument of that Congressman Atherly, as I've heard him talk with the colonel. And what did the colonel say? The colonel reckoned it was his business to obey orders, and so should you. So shut your head. If ye wanted to talk about government, ye might say suthin about its using us to convoy picnics and excursion parties around, who come out here to have a day's shootin', under some bigwig of a political boss or a railroad president, with a letter to the general. And we're told off to look arter their precious skins, and keep the Injuns off em, and they shoot in or skeereen off the Injuns natural game, and R-P-R-O-V ender. Darn my skin f there'll be much to scout for f this goes on. And be gosh, of they aren't now ringin' in a lot of titled foreigners to hunt big game, as they call it, lord this and that and count so and so all of em with letters to the general from the Washington cabinet to show hospitality, or from millionaires who've been hobnobbin' with em in the old country. And darn my skin f some of em ain't bringin' their wives and sisters along too. There was a lord and lady passed through here under escort last week, and we're goin' to pick up some more of em at Fort Biggs tomorrow, and I reckon some of us will be told off to act as ladies' maids or milliners. Nothin' short of a good Injun scare, I reckon, would send em and us about our reg'lar business. Whoa, then, will ye? At it again, are ye? What's gone of the DD critter? Here the fractious near horse was again beginning to show signs of disturbance and active terror. His quivering nostrils were turned towards the wind, and he almost leaped the center pole in his frantic effort to avoid it. The eyes of the two men were turned instinctively in that direction. Nothing was to be seen. The illimitable plain and the sinking sun were all that met the eye. But the horse continued to struggle, and the wagon stopped. Then it was discovered that the horse of an adjacent trooper was also laboring under the same mysterious excitement, and at the same moment wagon number 3 halted. The infection of some inexplicable terror was spreading among them. Then two non-commissioned officers came riding down the line at a sharp canter, and were joined quickly by the young lieutenant, who gave an order. The trumpeter instinctively raised his instrument to his lips, but was stopped by another order. And then, as seen by a distant observer, a singular spectacle was unfolded. The straggling train suddenly seemed to resolve itself into a large widening circle of horsemen, revolving round and partly hiding the few heavy wagons that were being rapidly freed from their struggling teams. These, too, joined the circle, and were driven before the whirling troopers. Gradually the circle seemed to grow smaller under the winding up of those evolutions, until the horseless wagons reappeared again, motionless, fronting the four points of the compass, thus making the radii of a smaller inner circle, into which the teams of the wagons as well as the troopers' horses were closely wound up and densely packed together in an immovable mass. As the circle became smaller, the troopers leaped from their horses, which, however, continued to blindly follow each other in the narrower circle, and ran to the wagons, carbines in hand. In 5 minutes from the time of giving the order, the straggling train was a fortified camp, the horses corralled in the center, the dismounted troopers securely posted with their repeating carbines in the angles of the rude bastions formed by the deserted wagons, and ready for an attack. The stampede, if such it was stopped. And yet no cause for it was to be seen. Nothing in earth or sky suggested a reason for this extraordinary panic, or the marvelous evolution that suppressed it. The guide, with three men in open order, rode out and radiated across the empty plain, returning as empty of result. In an hour the horses were sufficiently calmed and fed, the camp slowly unwound itself, the teams were set to and were led out of the circle, and as the rays of the setting sun began to expand fan-like across the plain, the cavalcade moved on. But between them and the sinking sun, and visible through its last rays, was a faint line of haze parallel with their track. Yet even this, too, quickly faded away. Had the guide, however, penetrated half a mile further to the west, he would have come upon the cause of the panic, and a spectacle more marvelous than that he had just witnessed. For the illimitable plain with its monotonous prospect was far from being level. 100 yards further on he would have slowly and imperceptibly descended into a depression nearly a mile in width. Here he not only would have completely lost sight of his own cavalcade, but have come upon another thrice its length. For here was a trailing line of jog-trotting dusky shapes, some crouching on dwarf ponies half their size, some trailing lances, lodge poles, rifles, women and children after them, all moving with a monotonous rhythmic motion as marked as the military precision of the other cavalcade, and always on a parallel line with it. They had done so all day, keeping touch and distance by stealthy vedettes that crept and crawled along the imperceptible slope towards the unconscious white men. It was, no doubt, the near proximity of one of those watchers that had touched the keen scent of the troopers' horses. The moon came up, the two cavalcades, scarcely a mile apart, moved on in unison together. Then suddenly the dusky caravan seemed to arise, stretch itself out, and swept away like a morning mist towards the west. The bugles of Fort Biggs had just rung out. Asterisk, 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 asterisk. Peter Atherly was up early the next morning pacing the veranda of the commandant's house at Fort Biggs. It had been his intention to visit the new Indian reservation that day, but he had just received a letter announcing an unexpected visit from his sister, who wished to join him. He had never told her the secret of their Indian paternity, as it had been revealed to him from the scornful lips of Grey Eagle a year ago. He knew her strangely excitable nature, besides, she was a wife now, and the secret would have to be shared with her husband. When he himself had recovered from the shock of the revelation, two things had impressed themselves upon his reserved and gloomy nature: a horror of his previous claim upon the Atherleys, and an infinite pity and sense of duty towards his own race. He had devoted himself and his increasing wealth to this one object. It seemed to him at times almost providential that his position as a legislator, which he had accepted as a whim or fancy, should have given him this singular opportunity. Yet it was not an easy task or an enviable position. He was obliged to divorce himself from his political party as well as keep clear of the wild schemes of impractical enthusiasts, two practical contractors, and the still more helpless bigotry of Christian civilizers, who would have regenerated the Indian with a text which he did not understand and they were unable to illustrate by example. He had expected the opposition of lawless frontiersmen and ignorant settlers as roughly indicated in the conversation already recorded. Indeed, he had felt it difficult to argue his humane theories under the smoking roof of a raided settler's cabin, whose owner, however, had forgotten his own repeated provocations, or the trespass of which he was proud. But Atherley's unaffected and unobtrusive zeal, his fixity of purpose, his undoubted courage, his self-abnegation, and above all the gentle melancholy and half-philosophical wisdom of this new missionary, won him the respect and assistance of even the most callous or the most skeptical of officials. The Secretary of the Interior had given him carte blanche, the President trusted him, and it was said had granted him extraordinary powers. Oddly enough, it was only his own Californian constituency, who had once laughed at what they deemed his early aristocratic pretensions, who now found fault with his democratic philanthropy. That a man who had been so well received in England the news of his visit to Ashley Grange had been duly recorded should sink so low as to take up with the engines of his own country galled their republican pride. A few of his personal friends regretted that he had not brought back from England more conservative and fashionable graces, and had not improved his opportunities. Unfortunately, there was no essentially English policy of trusting aborigines that they knew of. In his gloomy self-scrutiny, he had often wondered if he ought not to openly proclaim his kinship with the despised race, but he was always deterred by the thought of his sister and her husband, as well as by the persistent doubt whether his advocacy of Indian rights with his fellow countrymen would be as well served by such a course. And here again he was perplexed by a singular incident of his early missionary efforts which he had at first treated with cold surprise, but to which later reflection had given a new significance. After Grey Eagle's revelation, he had made a pilgrimage to the Indian country to verify the statements regarding his dead father, the Indian chief Silver Cloud. Despite the confusion of tribal dialects, he was amazed to find that the Indian tongue came back to him almost as a forgotten boyish memory, so that he was soon able to do without an interpreter, but not until that functionary, who knew his secret, appeared one day as a more significant ambassador. Grey Eagle says if you want truly to be a brother to his people, you must take a wife among them. He loves you, take one of his. Peter, through whose veins, albeit of mixed blood, ran that Puritan I so often found throughout the Great West, was frigidly amazed. In vain did the interpreter assure him that the wife in question, Little Daybreak, was a wife only in name, a prudent reserve kept by Grey Eagle in the orphan daughter of a brother brave. But Peter was adamant. Whatever answer the interpreter returned to Grey Eagle he never knew. But to his alarm he presently found that the Indian maiden Little Daybreak had been aware of Grey Eagle's offer, and had with pathetic simplicity already considered herself Peter's spouse. During his stay at the encampment he found her sitting before his lodge every morning. A girl of 16 in years, a child of 6 in intellect, she flashed her little white teeth upon him when he lifted his tent flap, content to receive his grave, melancholy bow, or patiently trotted at his side carrying things he did not want, which she had taken from the lodge. When he sat down to work, she remained seated at a distance, looking at him with glistening beady eyes like blackberries set in milk, and softly scratching the little bare brown ankle of one foot with the turned-in toes of the other, after an infantine fashion. Yet after he had left a still single man, solely though his interpreter's diplomacy, as he always believed he was very worried as to the wisdom of his course. Why should he not in this way ally himself to his unfortunate race irrevocably? Perhaps there was an answer somewhere in his consciousness which he dared not voice to himself. Since his visit to the English Atherleys, he had put resolutely aside everything that related to that episode, which he now considered was an unhappy imposture. But there were times when a vision of Lady Elfrida, gazing at him with wondering, fascinated eyes, passed across his fancy, even the contact with his own race and his thoughts of their wrongs recalled to him the tomb of the soldier Atherly and the carven captive savage supporter. He could not pass the upright supported bier of an Indian brave slowly desiccating in the desert air without seeing in the dead warrior's paraphernalia of arms and trophies some resemblance to the cross-legged crusader on whose marble effigy she had girlishly perched herself as she told the story of her ancestors. Yet only the peaceful gloom and repose of the old church touched him now. Even she, too, with all her glory of English girlhood, seemed to belong to that remote past. She was part of the restful quiet of the church, the yews in the quaint old churchyard might have waved over her as well. Still, he was eager to see his sister, and if he should conclude to impart to her his secret, she might advise him. At all events, he decided to delay his departure until her arrival, a decision with which the commanding officer concurred, as a foraging party had that morning discovered traces of Indians in the vicinity of the fort, and the lately arrived commissary train had reported the unaccountable but promptly prevented stampede. Unfortunately, his sister Jenny appeared accompanied by her husband, who seized an early opportunity to take Peter aside and confide to him his anxiety about her health, and the strange fits of excitement under which she occasionally labored. Remembering the episode of the Californian woods 3 years ago, Peter stared at this good-natured, good-looking man, whose life he had always believed she once imperiled, and wondered more than ever at their strange union. "Do you ever quarrel?" asked Peter bluntly. "No," said the good-hearted fellow warmly, "never. We have never had a harsh word, she's the dearest girl, the best wife in the world to me," but he hesitated, "you know there are times when I think she confounds me with somebody else, and is strange. Sometimes when we are in company she stands alone and stares at everybody, without saying a word, as if she didn't understand them. Or else she gets painfully excited and dances all night until she is exhausted. I thought, perhaps," he added timidly, "that you might know, and would tell me if she had any singular experience as a child, any illness, or," he went on still more gently, "if perhaps her mother or father." "No," interrupted Peter almost brusquely, with the sudden conviction that this was no time for revelation of his secret, "no, nothing. The doctor says," continued Lascelles with that hesitating, almost mystic delicacy with which most gentlemen approach a subject upon which their wives talk openly, "that it may be owing to Jenny's peculiar state of health just now, you know, and that if all went well, you know, and there should be, don't you see, a little child." Peter interrupted him with a start. "A child? Jenny's child? Silver Cloud's grandchild? This was a complication he had not thought of. No. It was too late to tell his secret now. He only nodded his head abstractedly and said coldly, "I dare say he is right." Nevertheless, Jenny was looking remarkably well. Perhaps it was the excitement of travel and new surroundings, but her tall, lithe figure, nearly half a head taller than her husband's, was a striking one among the officers' wives in the commandant's sitting room. Her olive cheek glowed with a faint illuminating color, there was something even patrician in her slightly curved nose and high cheekbones, and her smile, rare even in her most excited moments, was, like her brother's, singularly fascinating. The officers evidently thought so too, and when the young lieutenant of the commissary escort, fresh from West Point and flirtation walk, gallantly attached himself to her, the ladies were slightly scandalized at the naive air of camaraderie with which Mrs. Lascelles received his attentions. Even Peter was a little disturbed. Only Lascelles, delighted with his wife's animation, and pleased at her success, gazed at her with unqualified admiration. Indeed, he was so satisfied with her improvement, and so sanguine of her ultimate recovery, that he felt justified in leaving her with her brother and returning to Omaha by the regular mail wagon next day. There was no danger to be apprehended in her accompanying Peter, they would have a full escort, the reservation lay in a direction unfrequented by marauding tribes, the road was the principal one used by the government to connect the fort with the settlements, and well traveled, the officers' wives had often journeyed thither. The childish curiosity and high spirits which Jenny showed on the journey to the reservation was increased when she reached it and drew up before the house of the Indian agent. Peter was relieved, he had been anxious and nervous as to any instinctive effect which might be produced on her excitable nature by a first view of her own kinsfolk, although she was still ignorant of her relationship. Her interest and curiosity, however, had nothing abnormal in it. But he was not prepared for the effect produced upon them at her first appearance. A few of the braves gathered eagerly around her, and one even addressed her in his own guttural tongue, at which she betrayed a slight feeling of alarm, and Peter saw with satisfaction that she drew close to him. Knowing that his old interpreter and Gray Eagle were of a different and hostile tribe 100 miles away, and that his secret was safe with them, he simply introduced her as his sister. But he presently found that the braves had added to their curiosity a certain suspiciousness and sullen demeanor, and he was glad to resign his sister into the hands of the agent's wife, while he prosecuted his business of examination and inspection. Later, on his return to the cabin, he was met by the agent, who seemed to be with difficulty suppressing a laugh. "Your sister is exciting quite a sensation here," he said. "Do you know that some of these idiotic braves and the medicine man insist upon it that she's a squaw, and that you're keeping her in captivity against your plighted faith to them? You'll excuse me," he went on with an attempt to recover his gravity, "troubling you with their DD fool talk, and you won't say anything to her about it, but I thought you ought to know it on account of your position among them. You don't want to lose their confidence, and you know how easily their scary faculties are stampeded with an idea." "Where is she now?" demanded Peter, with a darkening face. "Somewhere with the squaws, I reckon. I thought she might be a little scared of the braves, and I've kept them away. She's all right, you know, only if you intend to stay here long-eyed." But Peter was already striding away in the direction of a thicket of cottonwood where he heard the ripple of women's and children's voices. When he had penetrated it, he found his sister sitting on a stump, surrounded by a laughing, gesticulating crowd of young girls and old women, with a tightly swaddled papoose in her lap. Some of them had already half mischievously, half curiously possessed themselves of her dust cloak, hat, parasol, and gloves, and were parading before her in their grotesque finery, apparently as much to her childish excited amusement as their own. She was even answering their gesticulations with equivalent gestures in her attempt to understand them, and trying amidst shouts of laughter to respond to the monotonous chant of the old women who were zigzagging a dance before her. With the gaily striped blankets lying on the ground, the strings of beads, wampum, and highly colored feathers hanging from the trees, and the flickering lights and shadows, it was an innocent and even idyllic picture, but the more experienced Peter saw in the performances only the uncertain temper and want of consecutive idea of playing animals, and the stolid unwinking papoose in his sister's lap gave his sentiment a momentary shock. Seeing him approach, she ran to meet him, the squaws and children slinking away from his grave face. "I have had such a funny time, Peter. Only to think of it, I believe they've never seen men or women with decent clothes before. Of course the settlers' wives don't dress much, and I believe they'd have had everything I possess if you hadn't come. But they're too funny for anything. It was killing to see them put on my hat wrong side before, and try to make one out of my parasol. But I like them a great deal better than those gloomy chiefs, and I think I understand them almost. And do you know, Peter, somehow I seem to have known them all before. And those dear little papooses, aren't they ridiculously lovely?" I only wish she stopped, for Peter had somewhat hurriedly taken the Indian boy from her arms and restored it to the frightened mother. A singular change came over her face, and she glanced at him quickly. But she resumed, with a heightened color, "I like it ever so much better here than down at the fort. And ever so much better than New York. I don't wonder that you like them so much, Peter, and are so devoted to them. Don't be angry, dear, because I let them have my things. I'm sure I never cared particularly for them, and I think it would be such fun to dress as they do." Peter remembered keenly his sudden shock at her precipitate change to bright colors after leaving her novitiate at the Sacred Heart. "I do hope," she went on eagerly, "that we are going to stay a long time here." "We are leaving tomorrow," he said curtly. "I find I have urgent business at the fort." And they did leave. None too soon, thought Peter and the Indian agent, as they glanced at the faces of the dusky chiefs who had gathered around the cabin. Luckily, the presence of their cavalry escort rendered any outbreak impossible, and the stoical taciturnity of the race kept Peter from any verbal insult. But Mrs. Lascelles noticed their lowering dissatisfaction, and her eyes flashed. "I wonder you don't punish them," she said simply. For a few days after their return she did not allude to her visit, and Peter was beginning to think that her late impressions were as volatile as they were childlike. He devoted himself to his government report, and while he kept up his communications with the reservation and the agent, for the present domiciled himself at the fort. Colonel Bryce, the commandant, though doubtful of civilians, was not slow to appreciate the difference of playing host to a man of Atherley's wealth and position, and even found in Peter's reserve and melancholy an agreeable relief to the somewhat boisterous and material recreations of garrison life, and a gentle check upon the younger officers. For, while Peter did not gamble or drink, there was yet an unobtrusive and gentle dignity in his abstention that relieved him from the attitude of a prig or an example. Mrs. Lascelles was popular with the officers, and accepted more tolerantly by the wives, since they recognized her harmlessness. Once or twice she was found apparently interested in the gesticulations of a few friendlies who had penetrated the parade ground of the fort to barter beads and wampum. The colonel was obliged at last to caution her against this, as it was found that in her inexperience she had given them certain articles that were contraband of the rules, and finally to stop them from an intrusion which was becoming more frequent and annoying. Left thus to herself, she relieved her isolation by walks beyond the precincts of the garrison, where she frequently met those friendly wanderers, chiefly squaws and children. Here she was again cautioned by the commander. "Don't put too much faith in those creatures, Mrs. Lascelles." Jenny elevated her black brows and threw up her arched nose like a charger. "I'm not afraid of old women and children," she said loftily. "But I am," said the colonel gravely. "It's a horrible thing to think of, but these feeble old women and innocent children are always selected to torture the prisoners taken by the braves, and, by Jove, they seem to like it." Thus restricted, Mrs. Lascelles fell back upon the attentions of Lieutenant Forsyth, whose gallantry was always as fresh as his smart cadet-like tunics, and they took some rides together. Whether it was military caution or the feminine discretion of the colonel's wife to the quiet amusement of the other officers, a trooper was added to the riding party by the order of the colonel, and thereafter it consisted of three. One night, however, The writers did not appear at dinner, and there was considerable uneasiness mingled with some gossip throughout the garrison. It was already midnight before they arrived, and then with horses blown and trembling with exhaustion, and the whole party bearing every sign of fatigue and disturbance. The colonel said a few sharp, decisive words to the subaltern, who, pale and reticent, plucked at his little mustache, but took the whole blame upon himself. He and Mrs. Lascelles had, he said, outridden the trooper and got lost. It was late when Cassidy, the trooper, found them, but it was no fault of his, and they had to ride at the top of their speed to cover the ground between them and the fort. It was noticed that Mrs. Lascelles scarcely spoke to Forsyth, and turned abruptly away from the colonel's interrogations and went to her room. Peter, absorbed in his report, scarcely noticed the incident, nor the singular restraint that seemed to fall upon the little military household for a day or two afterwards. He had accepted the lieutenant's story without comment or question. He knew his own sister too well to believe that she had lent herself to a flirtation with Forsyth. Indeed, he had rather pitied the young officer when he remembered Lascelles's experience in his early courtship. But he was somewhat astonished one afternoon to find the trooper Cassidy alone in his office. "I thought I'd make bold to have a word wid ye, sir," he said, recovering from a stiff salute with his fingers nipping the cord of his trousers. "It's not for meself, sir, although the old man was hard on me, nor for the leddy, your sister, but for the sake of the lieutenant, sir, who the old man was hardest on of all. I was of the party that rode with your sister." "Yes, yes, I remember, I heard the story," said Peter. "She and Mr. Forsyth got lost. Axin' your pardon, sir, she didn't." "Mr. Forsyth Lloyd. Lloyd like an officer and a gentleman as he is, God bless him to save a lady, more betoken your sister, sir. They never got lost, sir. We was all three together from the time we started till we got back, and it's the love of God that we ever got back at all. And it's breaking me heart, sir, to see him going round with the black looks of everybody upon him, and he ain't twirling his mustache and pretending not to mind." "What do you mean?" said Peter, uneasily. "I mean to be telling you what happened, sir," said Cassidy stoutly. "When we started out I fell three files to the rear, as became me, so as not to be in the way o' their colloguing, but sorra a bit o' straggling was there, and I kept them afore me all the time. When we got to Post Oak Bottom the leddy peens her whip off to the right, and says she, 'It's a fine bit of turf there, Mr. Forsyth, invitin' like,' and with that she gallops away to the right. The lieutenant follows her, and I closed up the rear. So we rides away in O's hent like amongst the trees, me thinking only it wore a mighty queer place for maneuvering, until we seed, just beyond us in the hollow, the smoke of an engine camp and a lot of women and childer. And Mrs. Lascelles gets off and goes to discoursin and blarneying wid em, and I sees Mr. Forsyth glancing round and looking uneasy. Then he goes up and says something to your sister, and she won't give him a hearing. And then he tells her she must mount and be off. And she turns upon him, bedad, like a tager, and bids him be off himself. Then he comes to me and says he, 'I don't like the look o' this, Cassidy,' says he, 'the woods behind is full of braves,' says he. 'Through for you, lieutenant,' says I, 'it's into a trap that the leddy hez led us, God save her.' 'Whisht,' he says, 'take my horse, it's the strongest. Go beside her, and when I say the word lift her up into the saddle before ye, and gallop like blazes. I'll bring up the rear and the other horse.' With that we changed horses and cantered up to where she was standing, and he gives the word when she isn't looking, and I grabs her up, she struggling like mad but not uttering a cry, and I lights out for the trail agent. And sure enough the braves made as if they would folly, but the lieutenant throws the reins of her horse over the horn of his saddle, and whips out his revolver and howls em back till I've got well away to the trail again. And then they let fly their arrows, and begorra the next thing a bullet whizzes by him. And then he knows they have arms wid em and are hostiles, and he rolls the nearest one over, wheelin' and fightin' and coverin' our retreat till we gets to the road agin. And they daren't folly us out of cover. Then the lady gets more sensible, and the lieutenant persuades her to mount her horse agin. But before we comes to the fort, he says to me, "Cassidy," says he, "not a word o' this on account of the lady." And I was mum, sore, while he was shootin' off his mouth about him bein' lost and all that, and him bein' bully ragged by the colonel, and me knowin' that but for him your sister wouldn't be between these walls here, and I wouldn't be talkin' to yet. And sure, sore, ye might be tellin's the colonel as how the lady was took by the hysterics, and was that loony that she didn't know whatever she was sayin', and so get the lieutenant in favor again. "I will speak with the colonel tonight," said Peter gloomily. "Lord save your honor," returned the trooper gratefully, "and if ye could be sayin' that the lady told you it would only be the merest taste of a lie ye'd be tellin' and you'd save me from breakin' me word to the lieutenant." "I shall of course speak to my sister first," returned Peter, with a guilty consciousness that he had accepted the trooper's story mainly from his previous knowledge of his sister's character. Nevertheless, in spite of this foregone conclusion, he did speak to her. To his surprise she did not deny it. Lieutenant Forsyth, a vain and conceited fool whose silly attentions she had accepted solely that she might get recreation beyond the fort, had presumed to tell her what she must do. As if she was one of those stupid officers' wives or sisters. And it never would have happened if he, Peter, had let her remain at the reservation with the Indian agent's wife, or if Charlie, the gentle Lascelles, were here. He would have let her go, or taken her there. Besides, all the while she was among friends, his, Peter's own friends, the people whose cause he was championing. In vain did Peter try to point out to her that these people were still children in mind and impulse, and capable of vacillation or even treachery. He remembered he was talking to a child in mind and impulse, who had shown the same qualities, and in trying to convince her of her danger he felt he was only voicing the common arguments of his opponents. He spoke also to the colonel, excusing her through her ignorance, her trust in his influence with the savages, and the general derangement of her health. The colonel, relieved of his suspicions of a promising young officer, was gentle and sympathetic, but firm as to Peter's future course. In a moment of caprice and willfulness she might imperil the garrison as she had her escort, and, more than that, she was imperiling Peter's influence with the Indians. Absurd stories had come to his ears regarding the attitude of the reservation towards him. He thought she ought to return home as quickly as possible. Fortunately, an opportunity offered. The general commanding had advised him of the visit to the fort of a party of English tourists who had been shooting in the vicinity, and who were making the fort the farthest point of their western excursion. There were three or four ladies in the party, and as they would be returning to the line of railroad under escort, she could easily accompany them. This, added Colonel Carter, was also Mrs. Carter's opinion. She was a woman of experience, and had a married daughter of her own. In the meantime, Peter had better not broach the subject to his sister, but trust to the arrival of the strangers, who would remain for a week, and who would undoubtedly divert Mrs. Lascelles's impressible mind, and eventually make the proposition more natural and attractive. In the interval, Peter revisited the reservation, and endeavored to pacify the irritation that had sprung from his previous inspection. The outrage at Post Oak Bottom, he was assured, had no relation to the incident at the reservation, but was committed by some stragglers from other tribes who had not yet accepted the government bounty, yet had not been thus far classified as hostile. There had been no ghost dancing nor other indication of disturbance. The colonel had not deemed it necessary to send out an exemplary force, or make a counter demonstration. The incident was allowed to drop. At the reservation, Peter had ignored the previous conduct of the chiefs towards him, had with quiet courage exposed himself fully unarmed and unattended amongst them, and had as fully let it be known that this previous incident was the reason that his sister had not accompanied him on his second visit. He left them at the close of the second day more satisfied in his mind, and perhaps in a more enthusiastic attitude towards his report. As he came within sound of the sunset bugles, he struck a narrower trail which led to the fort, through an oasis of oaks and cottonwoods and a small stream or branch, which afterwards lost itself in the dusty plain. He had already passed a few settlers' cabins, a sutler's shop, and other buildings that had sprung up around this armed nucleus of civilization which, in due season, was to become a frontier town. But as yet the brief wood was wild and secluded, frequented only by the women and children of the fort, within whose protecting bounds it stood, and to whose formal parade, and trim white and green cottage quarters, it afforded an agreeable relief. As he rode abstractedly forward under the low cottonwood vault, he felt a strange influence stealing over him, an influence that was not only a present experience but at the same time a far-off memory. The concave vault above deepened, the sunset light from the level horizon beyond streamed through the leaves as through the checkers of stained glass windows, through the two shafts before him stretched the pillared aisles of Ashley Church. He was riding as in a dream, and when a figure suddenly slipped across his pathway from a column-like tree trunk, he woke with the disturbance and sense of unreality of a dream. For he saw Lady Elfrida standing before him. It was not a mere memory conjured up by association, for although the figure, face, and attitude were the same, there were certain changes of costume which the eye of recollection noticed. In place of the smart narrow-brimmed sailor hat he remembered, she was wearing a slouched cavalry hat with a gold cord around its crown, that, with all its becomingness and picturesque audacity, seemed to become characteristic and respectable, as a crest to her refined head, and as historic as a lily canvas. She wore a flannel shirt, belted in at her slight waist with a band of yellow leather, defining her small hips, and short straight pleatless skirts that fell to her trim ankles and buckled leather shoes. She was fresh and cool, wholesome and clean, free and unfettered, indeed, her beauty seemed only an afterthought or accident. So much so that when Peter saw her afterwards, amidst the billowy, gauzy, and challenging graces of the officers' wives, who were dressed in their best and prettiest frocks to welcome her, the eye turned naturally from that suggestion of enhancement to the girl who seemed to defy it. She was clearly not an idealized memory, a spirit, or a ghost, but naturalistic and rosy, he thought a trifle rosier, as she laughingly addressed him. "I suppose it isn't quite fair to surprise you like that," she said, with an honest girlish handshake, "for you see I know all about you now, and what you are doing here, and even when you were expected, and I dare say you thought we were still in England, if you remembered us at all. And we haven't met since that day at Ashley Church when I put my foot in it, or rather on your pet protégés, the Indians, you remember Major Atherley's tomb? And to think that all the while we didn't know that you were a public man and a great political reformer, and had a fad like this. Why, we'd have got up meetings for you, and my father would have presided, he's always fond of doing these things, and we'd have passed resolutions, and given you subscriptions, and Bibles, and flannel shirts, and revolvers, but I believe you draw the line at that. My brother was saying only the other day that you weren't half praised enough for going in for this sort of thing when you were so rich, and needn't care. And so that's why you rushed away from Ashley Grange just to come here and work out your mission." His whole life, his first wild Californian dream, his English visit, the revelation of Grey Eagle, the final collapse of his old beliefs, were whirling through his brain to the music of this clear young voice. And by some cruel irony of circumstance it seemed now to even mock his later dreams of expiation, as it also called back his unhappy experience of the last week. Have you, he stammered with a faint smile, "seen my sister?" "Not yet," said Lady Elfrida. "I believe she is not well and is confined to her room. You will introduce me, won't you?" she added eagerly. "Of course, when we heard that there was an Atherly here we inquired about you, and I told them you were a relation of ours," she went on with a half-mischievous shyness. "You remember the de Bracys, and they seemed surprised and rather curious. I suppose one does not talk so much about these things over here, and I dare say you have so much to occupy your mind you don't talk of us in England." With the quickness of a refined perception she saw a slight shade in his face, and changed the subject. "And we have had such a jolly time, we have met so many pleasant people, and they've all been so awfully good to us, from the officials and officers down to the plainest working men. And all so naturally too, so different from us. I sometimes think we have to work ourselves up to be civil to strangers. No, she went on gaily, in answer to his protesting gesture, and his stammered reminder of his own reception. No. You came as a sort of kinsman, and Sir Edward knew all about you before he asked you down to the Grange or even sent over for me from the Towers. No. You Americans take people on their face value, as my brother Reggie says, and we always want to know what are the securities. And then American men are more gallant, though, she declared mischievously, I think you are an exception in that way. Indeed, she went on, the more I see of your countrymen the less you seem like them. You are more like us, more like an Englishman indeed, more like an Englishman than most Englishmen, I mean in the matter of reserve and all that sort of thing, you know. It's odd, isn't it? Is your sister like you? You shall judge for yourself, said Peter with a gaiety that was forced in proportion as his forebodings became more gloomy. Would his sister's peculiarities, even her secret, be safe from the clear eyes of the young girl? I know I shall like her, said Lady Elfrida, simply. I mean to make friends with her before we leave, and I hope to see a great deal of her, and, she said with a naive non sequitur, that, however, had its painful significance to Peter, I do want you to show me some Indians, your Indians, you know, your friends. I've seen some of them, of course, I am afraid I am a little prejudiced, for I did not like them. You see, my taste has to be educated, I suppose, but I thought them so foolishly vain and presuming. That is their perfect childishness, said Peter quickly. It is not, I believe, considered a moral defect, he added bitterly. Lady Elfrida laughed, and yet at the same moment a look of appeal that was in itself quite as childlike shone in her blue eyes. There, I have blundered again, I know, but I told you I have such ridiculous prejudices. And I really want to like them as you do. Only, she laughed again, it seems strange that you, of all men, should have interested yourself in people so totally different to you. But what will be the result if your efforts are successful? Will they remain a distinct race? Will you make citizens, soldiers, congressmen, governors of them? Will they intermarry with the whites? Is that a part of your plan? I hope not. It was a part of Peter's sensitive excitement that even through the unconscious irony of this speech he was noticing the difference between the young English girl's evident interest in a political problem and the utter indifference of his own countrywomen. Here was a girl scarcely out of her teens, with no pretension to being a blue stocking, with half the aplomb of an American girl of her own age, gravely considering a question of political economy. Oddly enough, it added to his other irritation, and he said almost abruptly, why not? She took the question literally and with a little youthful timidity. But these mixed races never attain to anything, do they? I thought that was understood. But, she added with feminine quickness, and I suppose it's again only a personal argument, you wouldn't like your sister to have married an Indian, would you? The irony of the situation had reached its climax to Peter. It didn't seem to be his voice that said, I can answer by an argument still more personal. I have even thought myself of marrying an Indian woman. It seemed to him that what he said was irrevocable, but he was desperate. It seemed to him that in a moment more he would have told her his whole secret. But the young girl drew back from him with a slight start of surprise. There may have been something in the tone of his voice and in his manner that verged upon a seriousness she was never contemplating in her random talk, it may have been an uneasiness of some youthful imprudence in pressing the subject upon a man of his superiority, and that his abrupt climax was a rebuke. But it was only for a moment, her youthful buoyancy, and, above all, a certain common sense that was not incompatible to her high nature, came to her rescue. But that, she said with quick mischievousness, would be a sacrifice taken in the interest of these people, don't you see, and being a sacrifice, it's no argument. Peter saw his mistake, but there was something so innocent and delightful in the youthful triumph of this red-lipped logician, that he was forced to smile. I have said that his smile was rare and fascinating, a concession wrung from his dark face and calm beardless lips that most people found irresistible, but it was odd, nevertheless, that Lady Elfrieden now for the first time felt a sudden and not altogether unpleasant embarrassment over the very subject she had approached with such innocent fearlessness. There was a new light in her eyes, a fresher color in her cheeks as she turned her face she knew not why away from him. But it enabled her to see a figure approaching them from the fort. And I grieve to say that, perhaps for the first time in her life, Lady Elfrieda was guilty of an affected start. Oh, here's Reggie coming to look for me. I'd quite forgotten, but I'm so glad. I want you to know my brother Reggie. He was always so sorry he missed you at the Grange. The tall, young, good-looking brown Englishman who had sauntered up bestowed a far more critical glance upon Peter's horse than upon Peter, but nevertheless grasped his hand heartily as his sister introduced him. Perhaps both men were equally undemonstrative, although the reserve of one was from temperament and the other from education. Nevertheless Lord Reginald remarked, with a laugh, that it was awfully jolly to be there, and that it had been a beastly shame that he was in Scotland when Atherly was at the Grange. That none of them had ever suspected till they came to the fort that he, Atherly, was one of those government chappies, and so awfully keen on Indian politics. Fritty had been the first to find it out, but they thought she was chaffing. At which Fritty, who had suddenly resolved herself into the youthfulest of schoolgirls in the presence of her brother, put her parasol like an Indian club behind her back, and still rosy, beamed admiringly upon Reggie. Then the three, Peter leading his horse, moved on towards the fort, presently meeting Georgie, the six-foot guardsman cousin in extraordinary tweeds and flannel shirt, Lord Runnybroke, uncle of Fritty, middle-aged and flannel-shirted, a mighty hunter, Lady Runnybroke, in a brown duster, but with a stately head that suggested ostrich feathers, Moyler Spence, MP, with an eyeglass, and the Hon. Evelyn Kane, closely attended by the always gallant Lieutenant Forsyth. Peter began to feel a nervous longing to be alone on the burning plain and the empty horizon beyond them, until he could readjust himself to these new conditions, and glanced half wearily around him. But his eye met Fritty's, who seemed to have evoked this gathering with a wave of her parasol, like the fairy of a pantomime, and he walked on in silence. A day or two of unexpected pleasure passed for Peter. In these new surroundings he found he could separate Lady Elfrieda from his miserable past, and the conventional restraint of Ashley Grange. Again, the revelation of her familiar name Fritty seemed to make her more accessible and human to him than her formal title, and suited the girlish simplicity that lay at the foundation of her character, of which he had seen so little before. At least so he fancied, and so excused himself, it was delightful to find her referring to him as an older friend, pleasant, indeed, to see that her family tacitly recognized it, and frequently appealed to him with the introduction, "Fritty says you can tell us, or you and Fritty had better arrange it between you." Even the dreaded introduction of his sister was an agreeable surprise, owing to Lady Elfrieda's frank and sympathetic prepossession, which Jenny could not resist. In a few moments they were walking together in serious and apparently confidential conversation. For to Peter's wonder it was the Lady Elfrieda side of the English girl's nature that seemed to have attracted Jenny, and not the playfulness of Fritty, and he was delighted to see that the young girl had assumed a grave chaperoneship of the tall Mrs. Lascelles that would have done credit to Mrs. Carter or Lady Runnybroke. Had he been less serious he might have been amused, too, at the importance of his own position in the military outpost, through the arrival of the strangers. That this grave political enthusiast and civilian should be on familiar terms with a young Englishwoman of rank was at first inconceivable to the officers. And that he had never alluded to it before seemed to them still more remarkable. Nevertheless, there was much liveliness and good fellowship at the fort. Captains and lieutenants down to the youngest cub, Forsyth, vied with each other to please the Englishman, supplied them with that characteristic American humor and anecdote which it is an Englishman's privilege to bring away with him, and were picturesquely and chivalrously devoted in their attentions to the ladies, who were pleased and amused by it, though it is to be doubted if it increased their respect for the giver, although they were more grateful for it than the average American woman. Lady Elfrida found the officers very entertaining and gallant. Accustomed to the English officer, and his somewhat bored way of treating his profession and his duties, she may have been amused at the zeal, earnestness, and enthusiasm of these youthful warriors, who aspired to appear as nothing but soldiers, when she contrasted them with her guardsmen relatives who aspired to be everything else but that, but she kept it to herself. It was a recognized, respectable, and even superior occupation for gentlemen in England, what it might be in America who knows. She certainly found Peter, the civilian, more attractive, for there really was nothing English to compare him with, and she had something of the same feeling in her friendship for Jenny, except the patronage which Jenny seemed to solicit, and perhaps require, as a foreigner. One afternoon the English guests, accompanied by a few of their hosts and a small escort, were making a shooting expedition to the vicinity of Green Spring, when Peter, plunged in his report, looked up to find his sister entering his office. Her face was pale, and there was something in her expression which reawakened his old anxiety. Nevertheless he smiled, and said gently, "Why are you not enjoying yourself with the others?" "I have a headache," she said, languidly, but, lifting her eyes suddenly to his, "Why are you not? You are their good friend, you know even their relation." "No more than you are," he returned, with affected gaiety. "But look at the report, it is only half finished. I have already been shirking it for them. You mustn't let your devotion to the Indians keep you from your older friends," said Mrs. Lascelles, with an odd laugh. "But you never told me about these people before, Peter, tell me now. They were very kind to you, weren't they, on account of your relationship?" "Entirely on account of that," said Peter, with a sudden bitterness he could not repress. "But they are very pleasant," he added quickly, "and very simple and unaffected, in spite of their rank, perhaps I ought to say, because of it." "You mean they are kind to us because they feel themselves superior just as you are kind to the Indians, Peter?" "I am afraid they have no such sense of political equality towards us, Jenny, as impels me to be just to the Indian," he said with affected lightness. "But Lady Elfrida sympathizes with the Indians very much. She—" The emphasis which his sister put upon the personal pronoun was unmistakable, but Peter ignored it, and so apparently did she, as she said the next moment in a different voice, "She's very pretty, don't you think?" "Very," said Peter coldly. There was a long pause. Peter slightly fingered one of the sheets of his delayed report on his desk. His sister looked up. "I'm afraid I'm as bad as Lady Elfrida in keeping you from your Indians, but I had something to say to you." "No matter, another time will do when you're not so busy." "Please go on now," said Peter, with affected unconcern, yet with a feeling of uneasiness creeping over him. "It was only this," said Jenny, seating herself with her elbow on the desk and her chin in a cup-like hollow of her hand, "did you ever think that in the interests of these poor Indians, you know, purely for the sake of your belief in them, and just to show that you were above vulgar prejudices, did you ever think you could marry one of them?" Two thoughts flashed quickly on Peter's mind: first, that Lady Elfrida had repeated something of their conversation to his sister; secondly, that someone had told her of Little Daybreak. Each was equally disturbing. But he recovered himself quickly and said, "I might if I thought it was required. But even a sacrifice is not always an example." "Then you think it would be a sacrifice," she said, slowly raising her dark eyes to his. "If I did something against received opinion, against precedent, and for aught I know against even the prejudices of those I wish to serve, however lofty my intention was and however great the benefit to them in the end, it would still be a sacrifice in the present." He saw his own miserable logic and affected didactics, but he went on lightly, "But why do you ask such a question? You haven't anyone in your mind for me, have you?" She had risen thoughtfully and was moving towards the door. Suddenly she turned with a quick, odd vivacity, "Perhaps I had. Oh, Peter, There was such a lovely little squaw I saw the last time I was at Oak Bottom. She was no darker than I am, but so beautiful. Even in her little cotton gown and blanket, with only a string of beads around her throat, she was as pretty as anyone here. And I dare say she could be educated and appear as well as any white woman. I should so like to have you see her. I would have tried to bring her to the fort, but the braves are very jealous of their wives or daughters seeing white men, you know, and I was afraid of the colonel. She had spoken volubly and with a strange excitement, but even at the moment her face changed again, and as she left the office, with a quick laugh and parting gesture, there were tears in her eyes. Accustomed to her moods and caprices, Peter thought little of the intrusion, relieved as he was of his first fears. She had come to him from loneliness and curiosity, and, perhaps, he thought with a sad smile, from a little sisterly jealousy of the young girl who had evinced such an interest in him, and had known him before. He took up his pen and continued the interrupted paragraph of his report. I am satisfied that much of the mischievous and extravagant prejudice against the half-breed and all alliances of the white and red races springs from the ignorance of the frontiersman and his hasty generalization of facts. There is no doubt that an intermixture of blood brings out purely superficial contrasts the more strongly, and that against the civilizing habits and even costumes of the half-breed, certain Indian defects appear the more strongly as in the case of the color line of the quadroon and octoroon, but it must not be forgotten that these are only the contrasts of specific improvement, and the inference that the borrowed defects of a half-breed exceed the original defects of the full-blooded aborigine is utterly illogical. He stopped suddenly and laid down his pen with a heightened color. The bugle had blown, the guard was turning out to receive the commandant and his returning party, among whom was Fritty. Asterisk, 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 asterisk.